Hi, I'd like to introduce Rudina Saini Kalath, whose works I've been following for 7 years now. She deals with the ideas of loss and disappearance in both historical and contemporary contexts. She looks at the lives of ordinary citizens caught in the contradictions and complexities of political and social conflicts, be it the Indian partition, state violence or control, and globalization. Trained in painting, Kalath works on a variety of unconventional materials, including bonded marble, fabric, earthenware, velvet, henna, and rubber stamps. Rina's abiding interest has been in the official records of loss. Her practice is based on research embedded in sociological data. Such loss is related to people, architecture, or even the Indian constitution. This is what artists do, bringing the forgotten to the surface.
What really interests me is history, mythology, and often these lead you to talking about memory, about whether it's personal memory, whether it's collective memory, and how memory plays out, whether it's sort of interference or it's cooperation in terms of what we remember and what we choose to remember and what we forget. And these are some of the things that, and also how information gets handed down to us. And as receivers of this information, how is it that our mind perceives and interprets this information? And that is something that has interested me a great deal. Well, I often think of the sort of fate of an individual in this sort of vast ocean of humanity, often being reduced to an anonymous statistic. And I sort of see each rubber stamp representing that individual in this sea of humanity. Somewhere in around 2003 was when I first started using the rubber stamp. And often I think for an artist, it's material that you chance upon, that's found material, and that then you incorporate when you see the potential of the material. And here was the rubber stamp that symbolizes it's sort of part of the bureaucratic apparatus, an object that both confirms and obscures identities. And I started to think of those individuals and identities who don't really get included in the political sort of sphere and don't get recognized as citizens belonging here. So there are these migrant communities in and around the neighborhood that I sort of keep going back to and photographing. And I sort of think of this sort of notion of loss, where they live at a sort of disconnect from their families, often here on work. Or for instance, Closet Quarry is another body of work where they're actually symbols of masons who were involved in the building of the Taj and other Mughal monument sites. And I've sort of inscribed these onto paintings. All through my growing years, I used to obsessively draw, paint, make things. It was something that was very intrinsic to my nature to constantly keep making things, whether they were like, you know, using imprints on fabric, whether it was craft things that interested me. And little did I realize that it would be such a strong calling. I think we sort of, all of us grew up with this understanding that we live in a rich multicultural society, and India is really known to be a country that has always sort of been inclusive, and there's a plurality of not just people, experiences. But there was a certain point in time, I think in the early 90s, when we were still at art school, and there was a definite erosion of that, the values that we've sort of grown to believe in. I think that was a period of enormous change within my own practice as an artist. Like, I grew up sort of listening to stories from my dad about how he was born in Lahore, which was all one nation before it got divided. the motive of the disputed territory that has been a sort of recurrent motive in my work has sort of almost come to symbolize the region of human inanity, of human folly. This is the region that is now called POK or Pakistan Occupied Kashmir, is the region of conflict. Both white heat and white yarn are domestic appliances. One is an ironing board made in bonded marble. What you find on the ironing board is, instead of ironing out the creases in the piece process, here's an iron that seems to have gone dysfunctional, and it has projections of tools and weapons, and interspersed within these weapons are decapitated religious monument heads. So you'll often find, or you'll find like a temple top or a church and a mosque, where the use or the misuse of religion, often, you know, employed as a tool, is suggested through this piece. And you find names of people who've signed the peace petition embroidered on this garment that sort of lies rested on this sculpture to be ironed out. These pieces have been shown in various exhibitions, say at Casa Asia in Spain, the Shanghai Zendai Museum in China, recently at the Göteborg Biennale in Sweden. A video which has called Silt of Seasons has a number of names that appear written on sand and then get slowly blown away, much like the peace process that doesn't seem to be coming to any sort of conclusive understanding. But having visited the Wagha Atari border and to see this sort of ceremonial change of guard, and this sort of wanted to collapse that in-between space of by having one gate from the Indian side of the border and one from the Pakistani side of the border that forms this sculpture as a third entity. And what you find wrapped onto the surface of the gates are sacred thread that is usually tied both in Hindu rituals and in Muslim rituals, of wishes that are unfulfilled and are meant to be untied once they are fulfilled. So the gates are just loaded with loads of untied thread, and these then almost go down, take roots, almost sort of fixing the gates as immovable, impermeable in a sense. And what you see at the edge of each gate is a fly zapper that is formed with the electric current and a UV tube. I mean, much like the barbed wire and fencing that you find at the border. Walls of the Womb is a piece I made in 2007. It was a period within my life where I was sort of going back, drawing from memory, from my own early childhood experience. It's a deeply personal piece because it has to do with my relationship with my mother, who I lost very early as a little girl. And the relationship that I'd built around the objects and things she left behind, whether they were her saris lying stacked in wardrobes for over 30 years, and I'd sort of built a relationship with these. What I chose to do at such a time, well, so much of motherhood is about nurturing, nourishing, and her handwritten recipe books that she left behind were material that I kept looking at for my own son to make him Indian recipes, like Indian sweets. And I decided then to translate these her handwritten recipes into Braille. And the work that I made was made through the process of tie and dye, where each dot that you see was first tied and then dyed. And the dots that you see are the virgin fabric. And I worked with craftspeople in Kutch, the northwestern region in India. And I wanted the experience for the viewer to be much like my own experience of being inaccessible and almost blinding, much like my own experience with her. You encounter when you come into the gallery. Walls of the Womb have been shown at the Hangar Bicocca in Milan, in Brazil, at Sesc Pompeii in Brazil. I was reading up about how over 200 objects or sites have gone missing, and of which 35 were meant to be protected sites under the Archaeological Survey of India. And it was really intriguing to know how is it that these have gone missing, whether it's due to rapid urbanization, due to builder lobbies. So the photographs became a reference for the series of paintings titled Falling Fables and sculptural pieces. For instance, the work that I showed at the Kennedy Center in Washington was a large pillar. I think the pillar is the sort of foundation of all architecture, and I had this fallen pillar made with over 30,000 rubber stamps that carried addresses of missing monuments. And interspersed with these were poem fragments on architecture and ruins. And so we started building this in the studio with mounds and mounds of rubber stamps that carried these addresses. And so it was all sort of planned out in such a way that we had to do all the preparatory work in the studio. And once we were on site, these were assembled as panels that went onto the surface of the sculpture. And it was also in the context of the Kennedy Center being a center for the performing arts and theater and so on, that this massive fallen pillar had its own sort of theatrical presence. I think as an artist, what one tries to do is to carry forward an idea through one's lived experience, whether it is an idea that can be critiques society, is an idea that speaks about the vitality of our condition, of the sort of and yet it can be invested with the kind of intellectual emotional charge. That is something that I'd hope the viewer can carry, those emotional responses besides the visual. At the workshop with young artists, the project that I'm working with is titled Visas to Happiness, and it's about allowing every child to think of their own space and imagine space that brings them happiness, whether it's to do with a person, a place, a site, an object. And we sort of went through a whole process of discussing what happiness means, not just by definitions by various philosophers, but how it's often sort of misunderstood and misrepresented as pleasure and something that's far more transient, and happiness being a far more abiding emotion, something that only depends on others and our surrounding. And of course you carry happiness within you, but how is it that happiness grows on spreading it?
Reena showed us a lot of her work, which kind of inspired us. She inspired me to put my deepest emotions onto the surface I was painting on. And that inspired me to draw this. It's kind of, it's a patchwork of all the things that make me happy.
Whatever makes you happy, you have to do, and you have to thought of that thing, and you have to come next, means today. These three ladies are praying to God. They have no religion. If we don't follow any religion, we will be together and united. So all the praise goes to Almighty. That's the my reason.
Happiness to me doesn't mean anything that we can achieve by any small things. It's if you do something good and just wait for something nice to happen to you, that gives me happiness. Helping someone out will make me feel a bit happy. Not what going for a movie or something like that. And my artwork, in my mind, I always had a conflict between good and evil. So in this is just me trying to come out of my evil side of my life and trying, really struggling because I've really taken into it. And around here are all the bad, dark treasure that are hidden inside, and I'm trying to come out.
What I've done is actually that it's like a key to happiness that each of these children will work on, but it collectively forms the map, the sort of world map.